Hey everyone, myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. Today we are going to discuss the economic relief measures that were announced by Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman yesterday. So let's begin the session, but before that, if you have not subscribed to our channel till now, then do not forget to subscribe and hit the bell notification. Guys, you can join this Telegram group as well, where you can get the latest updates as well as the quizzes on this channel. The link of this channel is in the description below. This is the RBI Grade 3 2022 course, guys. Before moving on to the special economic relief measures, let's discuss what this course has for you. So in this course, you will have PDFs, videos and mocks. And apart from this, you will also get the mock interviews for your final interview preparation. Here, you will also get a book kit that will contain all the books mentioned right in front of your screens. And right now, we are availing a 30% discount, which you can use by using the RBI 30 coupon code. The number is that you are seeing right now in front of you is the number which you can use to call us if you have any query related to the exam or about the course that we provide. So that was all about the introduction. Now let's begin the economic relief measures. Okay, so the first part that we are going to discuss about this economic relief measure is that there were a total of 8 economic relief measures that were announced by Nirmala Sitharaman, and this is a part of those 8 economic relief measures. So today we are going to discuss all the measures that were provided, announced by the finance minister yesterday only in detail. So the first one we have is rupees 1.1 lakh crore loan guarantee scheme for COVID affected sectors. So basically this scheme, this entire 1.1 lakh crore allocation has been divided into two parts. First part is for the healthcare sector and second part is for the other sectors. COVID affected sectors. So the sectors that are affected by the COVID, first is the healthcare sector, that is the most prominent sector that has been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. And the second part is for the other sectors that were affected by the COVID pandemic. For example, you can take the example of travel and tourism, you can take the example of aviation sector. So these are some of the sectors that were heavily impacted by the COVID-19, and in order to support those sectors, this 1.1 lakh crore has been allocated by the Government of India. Now, for the healthcare sector, the amount allocated is rupees 50,000 crores, and for the other sectors, the amount is 60,000 crores. Now guys, why is this what other sectors mentioned here? Because right now, the description of the sectors that will be included under this scheme has not been provided by the government, because they themselves have not decided which sector is to be included in this other sectors list. Because as per the need evolves, they will include the sectors in this other sectors list. So as far we have only the details about the healthcare sector. So the first fact that we will be discussing here about the four other sectors, because this is very short. So for other sectors, the loans that will be provided to the other sectors under this part of the economic relief measure, the interest rate will be capped at 8.25%. Guys, normal interest rate on loans is around 10 to 11%. So if this scheme would not have been provided by the government, then the borrowers would have to pay this much of interest rate. But right now, this interest rate has been declined to 8.25%. Now, that was all about the other sectors. Apart from this, you should also know this fact that the travel and tourism sector is also included in this other sector part. And for this travel and tourism sector, an extended economic relief measure has been provided. Okay, so now let's discuss the healthcare sector in detail. So first point here is that for the healthcare sector, the maximum interest rate for loans availed under this sector will be capped at 7.95%. So remember guys, this interest rate is important. So there would be similar kind of minute information that you would feel that they are not important, but actually they are important for you to memorize, because these kinds of economic relief measures are not only important for your phase 1 examination, but they can also be asked from you in your phase 2 examination. For example, the implication of providing the economic relief measure, the progress made under these economic relief measures and the impact of these measures on different sectors. So these are some of the dimensions of these economic relief measures that can be asked from you in your phase 1 as well as your phase 2 examination. So these kinds of details then becomes very important. Okay, the next point here is that the government will provide guarantee on the loans availed by public or private hospitals for expansion and new infrastructure projects in the healthcare sector in the underserved areas. So two things are very important here that are clarifying the purpose of this entire element of this relief measure. So the first thing here is that the loan will be provided either for extending the existing facility of healthcare or for launching the new infrastructure facility in the field of healthcare sector. For example, if you have to open a new hospital and for that you need loan, then you can go to the bank and avail the loan under this guarantee scheme, and that loan will be provided to you at 7.95% interest rate. But the condition here is that the loan should be, or the new project should be, in the underserved region. So that is the condition. I hope that this element is clear to you. This is basically specifying the purpose of launching this element, for launching this loan scheme specifically for the healthcare sector. Moving ahead with this only, so guarantee cover will be provided for expansion and new projects related to health and medical infrastructure in cities other than 8 metropolitan cities. So the big cities are avoided here from this segment. The next point here is that the guarantee cover will be 50% for expansion and 75% for new projects. So for example, if you are availing the loan for expanding your existing facility, then the guarantee cover for guaranteeing your loan would be 50%. For example, 50% of your loan would be guaranteed by the government. So this guarantee cover is nothing but the guarantee that the government is providing to the banks in exchange for loans provided by the banks to you guys. Okay, so 50% would be for the expansion and 75% guarantee will be provided for the new projects. And if the loan or the project is in the aspirational district, then this guarantee is increased to 75%. Maximum loan amount that an individual public or private hospital can avail is ₹100 crore, whereas the guarantee duration is 3 years, and the guarantee is provided by National Credit Guarantee Trustee Company Limited. So that was all about this healthcare sector. I hope that you won't find any kind of problem in understanding the first element of this relief measure. The next relief measure is about the extension of this emergency credit line guarantee scheme. Not extension, basically the additional amount has been added into the scheme. So the outlay of this scheme has been extended to ₹4.5 lakh crores. Earlier, when the scheme was launched in 2020, the outlay was ₹3 lakh crores. But right now, ₹1.5 lakh crores in this version of economic relief measures has been added to this emergency credit line guarantee scheme that was launched as part of the Atmanirbhar Bharat package in May 2020. Under this emergency credit line guarantee scheme, so far 1.1 crore units have availed loans up to 2.69 crore lakh crores out of the 3 lakh crore outlay. So guys, under this emergency credit line guarantee scheme, loans were provided to different units, and for that the guarantee was provided by the government. Apart from this, the contact incentive sectors have already been covered and will continue to be covered under this ECLGS scheme, and ₹4,000 crores will be provided to this sector under this scheme. Now, what is this contact intensive sectors? The sectors which require human contact. For example, the barber. The work of a barber requires the barber to contact with the other human. So that makes the barber more vulnerable to the COVID-19 pandemic, and it also impacts its business to a large extent in comparison to the person who is working in the service sector. So here the COVID contact intensive sectors are the ones that have been impacted by the COVID-19 pandemic severely. Okay, so that was the second relief measure. Then we have the third relief measure as the credit guarantee scheme to provide loans to small borrowers via MFIs. So MFIs stand for microfinance institutions. So these are the institutions that reach the smallest of the small borrowers. And the purpose is basically to tap those borrowers and provide funding to them so that the economy can be revived. So under this third economic relief measure, there is a cycle. Okay. First, the scheduled commercial banks will provide loans to these MFIs. Then these MFIs will provide further loans to the individuals. So this is a cycle. Okay. Banks providing loans to MFIs and MFIs providing loans to individuals. Therefore, the conditions applied to these loans vary in this segment as well as in this segment. So first we are going to talk about what are the conditions if the banks provide loans to the MFIs, and then we will talk about the terms and conditions when MFIs provide loans to individuals. So the first element here is talking about loans from banks to MFIs. So here the government will provide guarantee to scheduled commercial banks for providing loans to NBFCs, MFIs and MFIs for on lending to approximately 25 lakh small borrowers. Guys, here this 25 lakh borrowers is also a little bit of importance because finance minister herself emphasized this number that they are going to tap 25 lakh borrowers in the hinterland of India, in the underserved region of India, so that they can also be provided funding and the economy can be revived. The interest rate on loan from the banks will be capped at MCLR plus 2%. So MCLR is marginal cost of funds based lending rate. At that rate plus 2%, on that rate the loan will be provided to the MFIs. Maximum loan tenure for MFIs will be 3 years. MFIs will have to use 80% of these loans for incremental lending at interest rate of 2% below the maximum rate prescribed by RBI. So whatever is the maximum rate provided by the RBI, the MFIs have to provide loans at 2% lower than that rate, because if the loans are cheaper, only then the people are going to avail those loans. So that is the reason behind keeping the interest rate low. The next point here is guarantee cover will be till March 31st, 2022 or till the issue of ₹7,500 crores worth of guarantees, whichever is earlier. So whichever is earlier, the guarantee cover will be provided till that point of time. Now, what is the purpose of providing guarantee cover? It is not that MFIs will fail to provide the money back to the banks. It is for the purpose, for example, if a person has availed the loan from MFIs and that person defaults on providing the repayment, then the MFI will not have any option but to default on its payment back to the scheduled commercial bank. And in that case, this guarantee comes into play, because this guarantee is provided by the government. Therefore, the banks are openly providing the loans to the MFIs, and then only MFIs are providing loans to the individuals, particularly the small borrowers. Okay, so that is the importance of guarantee cover that the government is providing. The next element of this cycle is loans from MFIs to individuals. So maximum loan amount to the individual will be ₹1.25 lakh at an interest rate of 2% below RBI's prescribed. Focus will be on new loans via MFIs and not repayment of old loans. However, stressed borrowers excluding NPAs will be covered. All borrowers including defaulters of up to 89 days are eligible under this scheme. So, for example, all the borrowers that are willing to avail loans under this scheme are eligible for this scheme, even if they have defaulted on their loan payment, on their prior loan payment, for up to a day's period of 89 days. So if you have defaulted on your loan, for example, for the period of 89 days, then you are eligible for this scheme. But if the default is more than that period, then you are not eligible. Okay. The next point here is the guarantee of up to 75% of default amount for up to 3 years will be provided by National Credit Guarantee Trustee Company without charging any guarantee fee. So that is a very basic point. I don't think that there is any explanation required here. The next relief measure is the financial support to over 11,000 tourist guides, tourism stakeholders. So as I mentioned earlier also, that in the first point, the 1.1 lakh crore, the economic relief measure that was announced, that was divided into two parts, the healthcare sector and the other sector. So in that other sector, this tourism sector is also a part of that other sector. So the amount provided under this, the financial support provided under this element, under this relief measure, is a part of that 60,000 crore package that was announced under this first economic relief measure. Okay. Now moving ahead, working capital or personal loan would be provided to people in the tourism sector to restart their businesses impacted by the COVID pandemic. The loan will be provided under the new loan guarantee scheme. 10,000 regional level tourist guides who are recognized by the Ministry of Tourism or by the state governments are eligible under this scheme. The loan would be available with 100% guarantee up to the form. So 100% guarantee will be provided for the loans availed by the tourists who are recognized either by the Ministry of Tourism or by the state government. If they are availing the loan of up to ₹10 lakhs or 1 lakh, 10 lakh in case of travel and tourism stakeholders per agency, and 1 lakh is for tourist guides licensed at regional or state level. There would be no processing fees or no collateral requirements. The scheme is going to be administered by Ministry of Tourism through National Credit Guarantee Trustee Company. So I hope that there is nothing much that is complicated. All these are static facts that you have to memorize. Next is again for the tourism sector only. So free tourist visa to 5 lakh tourists. So the first 5 lakh tourists will be provided free tourist visa. So there will not be any visa charges that were earlier there for the first 5 lakh tourists. But that is available only till March 31st, 2022. Or if the 5 lakh visas are issued earlier than that, so that would be the limit. So whichever is earlier would be the limit for this visa issue. Total financial implication of waiving of the visa fee for the 5 lakh tourist is rupees 100 crores. The next economic relief measure is the extension of Atmanirbhar Bharat Rozgar Yojana, which was launched in October 2020. So guys, this scheme has been extended from June 30 to March 31st, 2022. So under the scheme, central government will pay 12% of the employee's burden of EPF, that is Employee Provident Fund, if the employee is drawing less than rupees 15,000 per month salary. The central government will also pay the remaining 12% of the employer's burden of the EPF if the establishment has up to 1,000 employees. But if the employees are exceeding the 1,000 number, basically there are more than 1,000 employees, then only the employee's contribution will be paid by the Government of India, and that for those employees who are drawing $15,000 or less than that. Okay, the scheme is being implemented by EPFO, and the purpose of launching this scheme was to increase the take-home salary of the people, basically to increase the availability of cash or liquidity with the salaried employees. So that was the purpose of launching this scheme, and particularly for extending the scheme right now. The scheme has so far benefited 21.42 lakh beneficiaries from 79,577 establishments since its launch till 18th of June 2021. The next relief measure is the extension of Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana till the month of November 2021. So the financial implication of extending this scheme is 94,000 crore, which makes the total contribution under this scheme to rupees 2.28 lakh crores. Under the scheme, you would know that 5 kgs of free food grains are provided to the poor people so that they can avail the one-time meal at least in a day. So that is provided under the NFSA, that is National Food Security Act. Guys, can you tell me when was this act implemented? This is your question for the day that you have to tell me in the comment section. Next economic measure is related to the healthcare sector, and let me clarify that this is different from the first element, the first relief measure that we read. The first relief measure was about 50,000 crores, and this is separate from that. This is 23,220 crores for the public healthcare sector, under which the ICU units, oxygen beds and supportive diagnostics, capacity surveillance and genome sequencing will be focused. So all these different kinds of dimensions of the healthcare are focused under this economic relief measure. Now guys, this amount is particularly allocated for 1 year. Okay, so that was another fact that you should be aware. Next comes the revival of Northeastern Regional Agricultural Marketing Corporation. So not only the relief measures focused on the healthcare sector, tourism sector and different kinds of sectors, but it also laid its focus on the agriculture sector. So in the Northeastern region, we all know that due to the lack of financial aid, the agriculture in the Northeastern sector was not that productive. Now the scenario is going to change because the government has decided to infuse 77.45 crores in the Northeastern Regional Agricultural Marketing Corporation, which is abbreviated as NARAMAC. This NARAMAC was established in 1982, and the purpose of infusing this money is to enhance agriculture, procurement, processing and marketing infrastructure in the Northeastern region. The next element is important, guys, because it is going to boost the exports of it. Okay, so 33,000 crores for NEIA and 88,000 crore for export insurance account. So these are basically the two different relief measures that have been announced. So we are going to discuss the first one right now. funding worth 33,000 crores will be provided to National Export Insurance Account for 5 years to support project exporters. First of all, you should know what is this National Export Insurance Account. So this was launched in 2011 by the central government so that the insurance will be provided to the exporters. What kind of insurance would the exporters need? The exporters need the insurance for their payment. So the exporters and the importers enter into an agreement with the Exim Bank so that the exporters would get their payment under the agreement. Now, how is it going to happen? Now, let us understand this. Exporters have signed this agreement with the Exim Bank and importers have also signed the agreement. So if the importer is defaulting on its payment, even then Exim Bank will continue to pay its obligations towards the exporters. Plus, it is also going to provide or fulfill its obligations towards the importer, for example, for the supplies. Okay, so that is the role that Exim Bank plays in the middle when this National Export Insurance Account is opened, when this agreement is entered by the exporters as well as the importers. So basically, in simple terms, you can understand it as an insurance for the exporters so that they can get their payments back even if the importer defaults. And for that, for availing that service, even these exporters pay premiums to the Exim Bank. So that is the incentive for which Exim Bank is entering such kind of an agreement. Also, apart from this, the main motive is to boost the exports of it. Okay, now what kind of exports are we boosting here? The project exports. Now what are the project exports? The project exports refer to the supplies that we make to fund the projects in different countries, particularly the infrastructure projects. So I hope that you have understood it well. What is the meaning of project exporters? The project exporters are none but the suppliers of the infrastructure projects in different countries. Okay. The next economic relief measure is again related to exports. So 88,000 crores are being provided to Export Credit Guarantee Corporation for 5 year period. Now this corporation promotes exports by providing credit insurance services. So again, the credit insurance service is going to provide assurance to the exporters. With the help of this Export Credit Guarantee Corporation, 30% of India's merchandise exports are supported and they are boosted. So that is the purpose of providing the financial aid to the Export Corporation right now. The next economic relief measure is the new streamlined process for PPP projects and asset monetization. Basically, this is not a relief measure but a statement that was made by the finance minister, or we can say that it is a vision that she has mentioned. So a new policy will be formulated for appraisal and approval of PPP proposals and monetization of core infrastructure assets, including InvITs. According to the government, the new process would ensure speedy clearance of projects to facilitate private sector's efficiencies in financing construction and management of infrastructure. So I hope that this is very clear. That is, a new kind of process will be evolved wherein the projects will get easily approved by the government. And guys, this is the last portion of the relief measure wherein we are covering the different assistances provided to other sectors. For example, these 3.03 lakh crores were provided to DISCOMs for infrastructure creation, upgradation of system capacity building and process improvement. Also, 19,041 crores will be provided for BharatNet project. Under this BharatNet project, what is the purpose? The purpose is to provide the internet connectivity to the rural and remote areas as well. So for that, this much amount will be provided. Farmers will get additional protein-based fertilizer subsidy of ₹14,775 crores. Now this amount is divided into two parts. DAP subsidy amount is ₹9,125 crores and NPK subsidy is ₹5,650 crores. You are not required to memorize this much. Just remember this amount. Next, the tenure of PLI scheme for large-scale electronics manufacturing scheme has been extended by 1 year till 2025 to 2026. Guys, this large scale electronics manufacturing scheme has already been provided in detail. So if you have not started it till now, then you can go and watch the video on this large scale electronics manufacturing scheme in detail. For today, that was all. That was the entire economic relief measures that were provided by the finance minister for handling the situation of COVID-19. Thank you so much for watching this video, and if you have liked it, then do not forget to share it among your friends. Thank you so much.